I was born in Bradley County on an old tobacco farm. I worked the fields from dawn to dusk, and I did nobody harm. We went to church every Sunday morning, Sunday nights and weekdays too. We learned about Jesus and how to make it through. Well, I'm going to see Jesus. He's the one who died for me. He traded beauty for those ashes, and he set my spirit free. And it fields were cropped by faith. God would help them to grow. Mercy was left in his hand when my dad began to sow. The yonder tractor kept us working as we did our very best. With two cylinders that made that noise, but that old putt-putt made us rest. Oh, I'm going to see Jesus. He's the one who died for me. Traded beauty for those ashes, and he set my spirit free. Last leaf was sold, felt we found the purest gold. We bought the groceries and we paid our bills. We went to church to give thanks for God who gave us strength to work another year in the field. Oh, I'm going to see Jesus. He's the one who died for me. He traded beauty for those ashes, and he set my spirit free.
Sure. me see if I can. One night while upon life's raging seas, looked as if I would suffer defeat. Darkness of night closed off the light. My heart sank with fear. I knew my destruction was a matter of time. Jesus stepped in and said, this old boy's mine. I'm safe from all harm, for he walked through the storm. Came looking for me. He came looking for me. He came looking for me. He made a way when there was no way that I could see. When I drifted far, Jesus was near. Rescue my soul and calm my fears. I'm safe from all harm, for he walked through the storm. Came looking for me. Satan had already picked out my grave. His plan had moved forward to put me away. I drifted so far, would anyone care that I should be lost? I knew my destruction was a matter of time. Jesus stepped in and said, this one is mine. I'm safe from all harm, so he walked through the storm. Came looking for me. He came looking for me. He came looking for me. He made a way when there was no way that I could see. When I drifted far, Jesus was near. He rescued my soul and calmed my fears. I'm safe from all harm, for he walked through the storm. Came looking for me. I'm safe from all harm, for he walked through the storm. Came looking for me.
My life from day to day. Walking on the water. Come along with me, for I want to see this man walking on the water. Well, he can raise the dead from the grave, change the water and turn it into wine. He can make the lame walk, he can make the lame walk, open up the eyes of the blind. Let's all go down to the river. There's a man that's walking on the water. Come along with me, for I want to see this man walking on the water. Well, Jesus is the man at the river, and he's washing people's sins away. He can save your soul if you give him control. Be ready for that judgment day. Let's all go down to the river. There's a man that's walking on the water. Come along with me, for I want to see this man walking on the water. This man walking on the water.
I was born in Bradley County on an old tobacco farm. I worked the fields from dawn to dusk. I did nobody harm. We went to church every Sunday morning, Sunday nights and weekdays too. We learned about Jesus and how to make it through. Well, I'm going to see Jesus. He's the one who died for me. He treated beauty.
Welcome everyone to Hickox Baptist Church this morning. Brother Michael White, if you will, how about open us in prayer this morning? If you're visiting with us, we're glad to have you here. I would like to inform you that the restrooms are through those double doors over there. If you got any more questions or anything, I'll be sitting right back there in the back. Feel free to ask me. We'll find you an answer. We're going to be having baptism tonight for Dylan Herring. Ladies quitting at 10 a.m. tomorrow. Also tomorrow, the office will be closed for Labor Day, and there'll be no school the second or third. On September the 8th, we're going to be having a church conference following the evening service. On September the 14th, Kaylee Blocker and Riley Johns would like to invite you to join them as they say I do. The wedding will be here at the church at 5 p.m., and there'll be a reception to follow in the social hall. It says, please RSVP to Camille at her phone number is in the bulletin. On September the 22nd, we'll be having an ice cream and a peanut social in the social hall at 5 p.m. Just a time of fellowship. Please come be a part of that. We had 76 in Sunday school this morning. Also this morning, I had a couple of classes looking for a new enrollment book. We found them after a little bit of looking, but if anybody else needs one, let me know and we'll get it. And just thank you for being here.
This morning, before I do forget and before the baby gets fretful, I would like for Stephen and his wife or whichever one bring the baby up here. Let's look at this new. Well, she ain't brand new, but because she's got teeth already, so. But the first time the church has seen her, and bring her up here and show her off. Her name is Clara, I believe that's right, Howard. I had to get confirmation from the girls in the back. I'd like to go back to that that song, Look What the Lord...
Amen. Would you stand with us this morning? This song says, King of Glory, fill this place. I just want to be with you.
Bow down and say you are King. let's start right now. Why would we wait? We can praise Him now. In victory, King of glory, fill this place. Just want to be with You. Just want to be with You. King of glory, fill this place. Just want to be with You. Just want to be with You. So we'll sing hallelujah until You come again. We'll dance in Your presence until You come again. I'll just sing hallelujah until You come again. And I'll dance in Your presence until You come again. King of glory, just want to be with You. Just want to be with You.
Soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hand. And covers me there with his hand. A wonderful Savior is Jesus my Lord. He taketh my burden away. He holdeth me up and I shall not be moved. He giveth me strength as my day. He hideth my soul in the cleft of a rock that shall such dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hand. And covers me there with his hand. When clothed in his righteousness, transformed, I rise.
One more time for me.
I think I got my mic turned on. I was scared to sing. No, I don't. If I ain't got it on now, it won't come on. Anyway. Y'all like that? That was better than test 1, 2, 3, which I just said it anyway. Hey, good morning, everyone. Whether we get the mic going or whatever, we're going to still preach. How about that? That's all right with y'all? If you have your Bibles this morning, turn with me to Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2. We think in the life and time that we're living in, we have the same privileges that folks did over 2,000 years ago. We can have a relationship with Jesus Christ. We can be born again. He's truly the same yesterday, today, and forever. He never changes his mind. It's some things like that in this life that we're not accustomed to, that promises that are kept. And everything that he has promised you, he'll do. And when he says he'll forgive your sins and cast them into the sea of forgetfulness, that's what he'll do. And also, if he says that he will return, as he told his disciples, to go into all the world and preach the gospel, and telling them that this same Jesus will come again in like manner, that he will do. And my friend, I'll tell you today, if you're not ready for that time, he could come in any moment, and we need to be prepared. So having said that, I want to know, how are you with Jesus, and what do you think about him? The scriptures here is... he's talking to the Philippian church and talking to the people. He says some things here that are really good. You know, I find these things in my life that is spoken here. I'm just wondering if you find the same thing. So if you look in chapter 2, if you would stand with me, I'm going to read a verse or two, and we'll get into the message this morning. But God's word is inerrant, infallible, and it deserves our respect as we stand and honor this blessed word. Verse 1 says this: if there be therefore any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any bowels and mercies, he says this in verse 2, fulfill ye my joy. Let's pray. Lord, we look to your word today, and God, we look for the Spirit of God to enlighten us on everything to say. We pray for the movement of the Spirit of the Holy Spirit, God, with each one. Just like the song that we just sung, God, we want you to fill our cup. Lord, fill it up that we can't take no more, and that's the way you are. Because you said that all things that belong to you that we have access to according to your riches and glory. And God, there is no end to your riches and glory. But God, now we need a touch from you. We need a movement from you, God, that will encourage us, make us strong. Not only that, Lord, it will cause the lost to be saved and the saved to be more energized for you each day. God, help us, Lord, as we stand. Open each heart and their mind. We ask this in your precious name. And all God's people said, amen. The first question asked in that first verse there said, if there be therefore any consolation. You know, consolation is a thing, and I know I've spoke on that before, but a little different twist this morning on it, not that it's changed its meaning or not, but sometimes a lot of times we do things because there's something coming back in return. You know, you watch your game shows on TV, you know, Let's Make a Deal or whatever it might be back in the day. I don't even know if they still have that anymore. But anyway, behind curtain number one. But what is so famous for the losers, the ones that don't have anything, they always throw in, we have a consolation prize. So what does that mean there is no one leaves there empty-handed. Everyone's going to go away with more than what they come with. And when we're looking at what he's trying to tell the Philippians here, he says, in that verse he says, if there is therefore any consolation, is there any comfort? My friend, I'm here to tell you there's more comfort that you can ever find in the Lord Jesus Christ. You think about what he is and what he does and what he will do. And he's never broke a promise. He's never told a lie. He's never said something that he couldn't do. He will do. You know, I even believe in, you know, sometimes we get questions sometimes. Do you really still believe that God said that if you had the faith of a mustard seed that you could move a mountain? I said, yes, I really believe that. If I wanted a mountain to be moved, and maybe, you know, some people think, I'm going to go to some Mount Everest and say, well, God told me to move this mountain. No, the mountain he's talking about in this life is serious problems in your life. You know, that you know we always think of physical things that we see. But what God is willing is to take that load off of you. And in the spirit and the promise of God, he says, if you'll believe in me, if you'll just have faith. You know, he may move it one shovelful at a time. Or he may take a bulldozer and flatten it all at one lick. But nevertheless, with the faith in Jesus Christ, the Bible says we can move mountains. And here, is there any consolation in that? Well, I'll say, if you say, well, I don't know. I don't know so much about that. What other help do you have that moves mountains in your life, or problems or situations? You know, sometimes they go in small graduations as things develop. You can see God moving and things begin to happen. And sometimes it's a slow process in our eyes. But you got to remember, God is not on no time clock. You know, only he alone knows when he's going to come back. But, you know, I really appreciate things about God in the long suffering. Although we want our problem solved quickly, but think about when we were the problem. And God was long suffering and didn't commence judgment on us and just stomp us out. You know, some of us don't believe, you know, that we're ever the problem. Well, I got news for you. If you're believing that, then you got a problem. So, I mean, sometimes we are the problem. You know, we are in that situations. But the consolation in believing and being born again is to know that Jesus is faithful and just to forgive us of all of our sins. Not only that, he offers us, I would say he offers us the world, but he don't offer us the world. He offers us a better place than the world, a place called heaven. You know, we can do all things through Christ, which strengthens us. And that is a consolation within itself. He'll never put more on you than you can bear. He is a mountain mover. He is a problem solver. And the consolation is he is a friend that sticks closer than a brother. Now, if there is, therefore, any consolation, my friend, it's found in Jesus Christ. And the next one, it says, if there is any comfort of love. Love is stretched and mimicked in many different ways. Some people want the physical relationship of love. But I'll tell you, in my mind, you know, that used to be high priority. But in reality, it's probably the least of all love. It is. It's the least of all. You can show love to one another by a hug or deeds or stuff like that. But to think about the love that is there, if there's any consolation, if there's any love in there, how strong a love? Well, the one that you and I can't do is called unconditional love. I don't care how great you think you are. Oh, I'm going to love you unconditionally. That means you marry this lady and you and her never disagree on anything. Well, that don't happen. Well, that's because it's not unconditional. Something happened. It wasn't under your right condition. Something happened there. But God sent his son Jesus when he come to die for us. He did it unconditionally. He did it. And he says, and here's the answer. He says, I love you in such a way that I can forgive sins even though you hate me. Hey, I can love you even though you are one that swung the hammer to drive the nails in my hand. He said, I could love you whether you was the one swinging the whip to whip me on the cross. I can love you even though you were the one that spat in my face. I can love you even though you doubted my mama, gave birth to me in a manger one time in Bethlehem. I can do that when you take my father's name in vain. I can do that when you live way past the rules of what God has for his own people. He says, I can love you in such a way. That's when John 3:16, that for God so loved the world. That so loved is an unconditional love. You and I can't fathom till the peace of God comes in our heart. Man, God is an awesome God. Not only is he the greatest consolation known to man. You know, I hope we don't take him that way. You know, well, I'll just live like I want to, and God is not going to throw me into the pits of hell. He's a loving God. Amen, preacher. He's a loving God. Well, I got news for you. He loved you so much that he wanted to die so that your sins may be forgiven to keep you from hell. But if your sins is not forgiven, it will put you in hell. Yeah, you know, you got to realize that. God is a loving God. There's no greater love than God. The Bible tells us that greater love have no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friend. But I can tell you, my friend, he loved us so. But do we love him so? You know, in the next part of this, it says, is there any fellowship of the Spirit? You know, I like that. You got to listen now. Consolation is things that's coming after, you know, that we're going to get. It's the added on to. You ever went to a gathering and you get there and there's a door gift? Some people call it a door prize. You know, we gave them away one time at the co-op on our 75th or anniversary, 80th anniversary of the co-op. We give everybody that showed up a parting gift. But we must have only gave it to the women. It was cast iron skillets, which could be used for good things or a weapon, however you want to look at it. So I'm not sure if it was all given in love or what. And, you know, there was a date on there to celebrate what was going on, and there might be a few dents in them now celebrating a moment that wasn't so good. We don't know. But the consolation is there. And then having the comfort of the love of God in your life. And now the fellowship of the Spirit. You know what's great for Christians? What's great for people who don't understand that we enjoy having the third part of the Godhead in our body. We enjoy having that moment as we lay down to sleep. Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I should die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take. And in the Spirit of God, we can rest in that to know that if we're absent from the body, that we're present with the Lord. What a moment in time. How do you realize that? Not only is it in the Word, but it is the Spirit that comes into you as a born-again Christian to give you that peace and understanding. You know, I'm not so worried about dying as how I'm going to die. And we all feel that way. I don't want to suffer. I don't want to die. You know, I ain't ready to check out anytime now because I like things down here. But if I were to die, and according to the Bible, it's going to happen. We all going to check out. We can't be here forever. It's not made for us to be here. We're going to check out of here or God's going to come back to get us. Either way, we're out of here. But to have the promise of the consolation and the gift of God, to have the comfort of the love of God that we're having, but having the presence of the Spirit of God while we're here. Man, I'll tell you, that's exciting. You know, most Christians sometimes when they get in a tight spot, you know, and things are on their mind and things get to happen, you may be caught talking to yourself when you're not talking to yourself. Now, I can tell you, you know, you could be praying to God, and somebody says, that dude's gone cuckoo. He's gone cuckoo. He's been talking. I see his lips moving. He's coming by me, and I see all that thing. And then next thing you know, he's coming by, and he's singing, glory, 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 saying something like that. But it's the Spirit of God. Let me tell you, I can tell you, you cannot get close enough to a person to know everything that's going on with inside them, but the Spirit of God can. The Spirit of God knows your problems. He knows your situation. And having that ability, it's not like going to the doctor and your appointment's at 10:45 and at 11:45 you finally walk in to see the doctor. The Bible says that he is ever present. He's instant. He's always on time. And that is that. Have you ever just wanted to call and talk to the doctor? You know, yeah, just talk to the doctor. You know, he can't be reached. He's so important, he can't be reached. But I feel like I'm important. But I can tell you what's better than that. You can get a hold to God anytime, anywhere. The comfort of the Spirit of God. Things may be troubling somewhere in another country or somewhere in another state or somewhere in another life, somewhere in your family, somewhere outside of your family, whatever. And you can have a little talk with Jesus through the Spirit of God. And what happens then? He makes it right. There's nothing better than to know at that point. Thanks, JJ. There's nothing better to know at that point. Have you ever wondered if you've done the best you can for anybody? Have you really went to that point that you can? Let me tell you, when you give it to Jesus, you've done the best you can. You say, well, I didn't give him no money. I didn't buy him a car for transportation. I didn't pay for the groceries. I didn't do all that. But if you gave him Jesus, you gave him everything. If you brought Jesus to their attention, or you got Jesus' attention because of that Spirit that dwells within you, that allows you. Did you know that we're kings and priests according to Him? We can enter into the throne room proud and with boldness that we're welcomed in there. Not that we deserve it, but because He welcomes us into His presence and we have the fellowship of the Spirit. Man, I'll tell you, I like the Spirit. Man, I like the Spirit. You know, I'm never alone. I'm never without power. I'm never with, and my wife says, I'm never without words to say. But we should none ever be without words to say if it's about Christ. Because the Bible says all the words have not been written in the Bible. So there's plenty more to use if you're a Christian. Don't make none up. Just ask Him. He'll give you something to say. And He'll make you fit the right situation. He's that kind of God. So we go on a little bit further. And not only that, he says, the fellowship of the Spirit, if any bowels and mercy. You know, I like that. You know, that first verse could preach the whole message. Any bowels or any mercies. The bowels of affection that we have here, and not only that, the mercy part. Let me tell you, the outflowing of the bowels of mercy. I got news for you. I have a religion. I have a relationship that I can feel. You hear me? I have, some people say, well, if you don't feel Him, then He's not there. If He's there, you're going to feel Him. You can get warm gooses, or you can get frozen chill bumps. You can get your hair stand on top of your head. You can have all kinds of things going on in your life. And when He's there, you can just feel it. It's there. And that's, the bowels is talking about the inner side. The inner side, that's where your bowels is at. But in the inner side, you got the mercy, you got the Spirit of God going on, and then you got the bowel. And when you think about it in the way that it's written there, you're talking about the bowels of mercy. What God reached down at this moment, some of you are here and you think you're here just for whatever reason you came today. But I got news for you. In the bowels of God's mercy, way down in there, He had a purpose. I don't believe nobody's here by mistake. I always believe you're here by divine appointment. You say, no, I got invited. Well, good. That began the bowels of mercy. God instructed someone to get to you and now you're here. Were you glad of it before you leave here? That's between you and God. But God set it forth from the whole thing. He says, listen, the number one thing is, the greatest thing you can ever get out of this is me, Jesus Christ. He says, that's one of the greatest things you can get out of. So at the worst thing you can imagine being a Christian, you get Jesus. Which is not the, you know, there's always a scale from 1 to 10. Is He 10, or is He 1, or is He 2? At His worst day, He's a 10. And at His greatest day, He's a 10 plus. If there is such a thing. On a scale of 1 to 10, He's 100. He is as very, the determining factor is the part about the relationship in the Spirit of God. So if there be any of those things, then that's all it's asking. If you can believe that there are these things, then you have all this to offer to you. You can have the very presence of God. You can walk in the Spirit of God. You can receive the blessings of the mercies of God. You can know beyond a shadow of a doubt. And when it comes, it's kind of like this. Have you ever apologized or had someone to apologize to you and you could really tell they were sincere? But have you ever had anyone, or have you ever done that, that where you did it and it was not sincere? That did not come from your bowels. The bowels of your heart, it did not come from there. But when it is, it usually comes like what we spoke about. It comes probably in a contrite spirit. It comes from a humble something in you. And God is like that, and He'll make you that way. He'll make you that way. I can tell you, if you wanna get to me, you make my wife cry. If you wanna get to me, I mean the nearest and dearest thing and other than Jesus in my life, you hurt that, then mean you got problems. But don't you think that Jesus cares like that for you? If Satan or the world or sinners or whatever, backbiters or whatever they are, critics in this life say stuff that brings tears to your eyes, what do you think God thinks about that? Oh, He loves you that much. And He gives you all this to go with it. And then He said in verse 2, He says, "Fulfill ye my joy, that you be like mine in having the same love," talking about the same love that Paul had for the Philippians, but also was the same love that Jesus has for us. He says that you have the same love. He says, being of one accord, of one mind. One accord, one mind. What's that? Well, it's kind of like the choir. They don't include me up there because sometimes I just sing wherever it feels good. And sometimes it don't sound good, but it feels good. But they do it and try to be all in one chord. And when they all on the same chord, they are of a chord. Do you get me? And when you put that together, that's a word we call harmony. Harmony means when everyone sounds a little different, but when it's put together, it's got a ring to it. It fits together like peanut butter and jelly. Grits, bacon, and eggs. I mean, it's just, it's one of those things. And that's what He's talking about here, my friend. It's putting us all together. He says, being one mind and one accord. Now, I said that to say this. When God's people this morning, if we all agree what the preacher man from heaven is saying through the shepherd boy down here, if we can agree with that and one mind and one accord, there's nothing we can't do. Not only that, there's nothing in this moment that can keep you from getting saved. There's nothing in this moment that could change your life forever. Man, when we leave from a place of refueling in the Spirit of God like it is this morning, I mean, this is the spiritual gas station. You know, you can come in here and plug up to the Spirit of God. You know, if here's something that's come along. Y'all got what they call them default plug-in things. Uh-oh, y'all in trouble. If you ever got one, you'll find out. That means if there's a default, that little baby, they got a little button on them and they'll pop out. And you'll go there, the wife will go there with the blow dryer and plug her in. Honey, something's wrong here. Something's wrong here. Ain't nothing in there. First thing you do, run to the breaker box. And if you like me, you'll want to be an electrician. You've bought a real nice tester that you Google to see how to operate it. And you run in there and you take a chance because I don't like electricity. And you skin them things off and you stick them in there. And you say this: if I got it right, there's no power in that plug. There's no power in that plug. So you call your buddy. That's an electrician. Man, I hate to bother you. What's going on there? He said, "What kind of plug you got? What kind of sediment?" He said, "What does it look like?" So you send him a picture. Ain't we good at that? You ever send a picture of something? Hey, man, you ever seen this before? You're already thinking big bucks. You got to have a specialist to come in there. Yeah. And just about the time you get off the phone, he's told you what to do. And your wife's been Googling it all there. And she walks back in there. Well, you're not around. She mashes that button. How smart do we feel? But I got news for you. Being a Christian, you can't trip that breaker only by sin only. Your walk in relationship is not dependent on me. I can't make Miss Betty or Sister Wanda, I can't make them not have a good walk with the Lord on my behalf. Now, I could hinder that walk, but that is, the Bible says, we work out our own salvation. You walk as close as you want. Hopefully, I'm here to aid you. Hopefully, Brother David, Sister Dottie are here to aid everybody, and they aid themselves. But the conditions are there. Listen, the consolation of the world that Jesus did on the cross of Calvary was to make it where you could step over and be born again. If you can find any of that. And how to make it be in harmony with the church, my friend, to draw all that back in. So there is no default system. The only default there is if sin is rampant. Y'all better be glad y'all wasn't close on that one. I'll back up. If sin can the only thing that trips the breaker. But the thing is, the generator's still running. The generator's still running. The fault is on our end. What a promise from God. What a promise from God. You know, one of the things, especially with the co-op world, is we want to have dependable electricity. Not only that, we want it affordable. As much as possible, even though I know you guys think going up is crazy. Hey, you ain't seen nothing yet. I'm just warning you. And it's out of our control. There's some things that could change this, but that'd be for y'all to decide. But the thing is, dependability is what God wants. He calls that word obedient. If you're obedient, you can be dependable. And affordability, he's took care of that because it don't cost you nothing but obedience and faithfulness. He paid it all on the cross. He did that. And all we can do when we put everybody that's like that together, we're in one mind and one accord. And I'll tell you, the earth will shake where that's happening. The rumor will be out. There'll be excitement. Don't you want enough of God to excite people to be so curious to come and check this thing out? Not that we are anything, but we're lifting up the name of Jesus, who is everything. Glory. Moving in the Spirit, giving them the truth that'll make you free and set you free. Free from what? Man, I'll tell you, you're not going to be free from your problems. You're not going to be free from trouble. But what you're going to be free from is anti-access to Christ. You can get plugged in. It'll never throw the breaker. The generator will not run out of electricity. And he's an ever-present help in a time of need. Poof! Nothing else out there will offer that. Walmart's tried to be the greatest pleaser of all. We're on 24/7. But you can still go there and the shelves can be empty. You can still go there and you can't control the price. They may have what you want for if you're willing to pay the price. Jesus has all you need and it don't cost you anything. He's done paid the price. But I say I ain't getting very far this morning, but that's okay. I think I'm getting far enough. Being of one accord, of one mind. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory. Say we get something done. I give kudos to my brother over here who heads up the pre-hunt. A lot on him. I know it's like he's probably passed out for the last week or so. But I'll tell you, all them little cards that we have sent out, if you're visiting here and you don't mind saying, and you came to the pre-hunt and you got a response from us, would you just raise your hand right quick? Two. They were already coming, but that nevertheless. But what I'm telling you is, if it wasn't but one, that man done told me it would be worth it all. You know why? Because there's one person who's going to spend eternity or has a chance to understand in the sweet by and by about what Jesus is. What would you give in exchange for your life to live with Jesus forever? Be careful. Let nothing be done in strife and vainglory, but in lowliness and of mind, let each esteem each other better than them. How do you achieve walking into newness of life? How do you achieve walking together in one mind and one accord? Is consider others. I think the old WWJD has kind of went out of the picture now, but it shouldn't have never went out of the picture. When you get to that point, you need to say, what would Jesus do? If you can't figure it out and you prayed and you say, what would Jesus do? Lord, what would you have me to do? The answer's on the way. But first of all, get yourself out of the way so he can put what he wants in there and then take that lead and go forward. Do what you got to do. Jut may not know this. I had a testimony about the lady that received the gun from one that came from folks and whatever. But she found out that she was going to give it to her daughter, somebody. She's an elderly lady. She didn't need a cannon for nothing. You know, Raid roach spray is about as strong as she gets. But she found out the only way that she could redeem that, because her name was on that ticket, and she had to go up herself. And in her discussion, she says, did you know that they tell me when I get there that I got to do a background check? How would you feel about that? Is there something in the closet somewhere that nobody knows, which it ain't nobody's business but yours and God's anyway? When you look in the mirror, do you always see that rearing its ugly head in there? Well, apparently you hadn't given it to Jesus. Because I got news for you. He knew what you was going to do. And he says, my grace is sufficient. That lady says, well, you know what? I don't remember. Sister Karen ain't here this morning. I can talk about her. The ladies was friends with her, and she says, well, I hope they won't remember how bad we were when we were in school. Now, when you get that old, you're supposed to be able to forget that kind of stuff. But I can tell you, if there's something outstanding, if somebody here this morning, probably, there's something outstanding in your mind right now that you're not sure that it's under the blood. First of all, everything can be put under the blood. Their Bible says that he is no respecter of persons. Don't think the only thing you cannot do to get covered is not accept him. Don't accept him, you don't get forgiveness. The only way to be forgiven is to come to him. But she says, I got to do a background check. My point is this. To receive the prize, to receive Christ, you have to go yourself to redeem it. Because your name is the only name that should matter to you if you're lost. If your name wasn't on the ticket, you don't get the prize. But I'm here to tell you, the Bible says that whosoever, that puts your name on it, shall call upon the Lord, shall be saved. So she was ecstatic to be able to give the gun to her grandchild. I don't know, don't care. But what was amazing to me is it was so strict that she had to be the one to go get it. Well, same thing in being born again. The Bible says there's certain times that people sit in heavenly places and partake of heavenly things. And there's moments that they see what the spirit of the movement, the fellowship of the Spirit of God is, and they like it. But there's a disconnect between time to do something about it and walking away. There's not always granted another day in this life. I don't use this as a scare tactic, my friend. I know I do funerals. I do birthdays. I do weddings. And those things are things that last for a little while. But you only do a funeral for one person one time. Because you only have one life to live. And at the end of that, it's over. We don't dig them back up. We don't send them to a purgatory. We don't send them to a holding place. Nowhere in the Bible can you find where that ever happened. When the rich man and Lazarus died, the Bible showed a picture there that Lazarus was in Father Abraham's bosom. The rich man opened his eyes and he was in hell. That's a true picture. No smoke, no flaming, just telling you that's the way it's going to be. But other than paradise now, it's a shame. You know why paradise got took out of the center of the earth? To make hell bigger. And heaven be built in the third heaven. You said, oh, Brother Jamie, well, where did Jesus go in those 3 days? The Bible says that he went and done business with Satan, didn't he? And he went down in the heart of the earth where the Bible says that they kind of done battle. And he bruised his heel on Satan's head. Well, did they literally duke it out? No, I think the bruising was a humiliation thing. He said, Satan, if you want more where that comes from for a few days, you better stay away. Because at that time, the devil had control of a few keys. But when Jesus overcome death, he come back with the keys. What did he come back with, Brother James? Will he come back to keys of death? If he can give it, he has the right to take it. And he should be able to control it if we let him. And then he took the keys away from him to hell. You say, well, what does that matter? Well, people are still going to be able to go there if you so choose. But that key will be used later on. When he throws old devil and all the angels and all the demons down in there with all the lost people that don't get saved, throws them in there and he locks away for good. And the last one, the grave. See, for eons of time, the grave represented the ending place. But Jesus defied that. On that day, no grave, no pile of dirt could hold him. No cave made by man. Joseph of Arimathea had enough money to build one that was good for anybody else in the whole world. But yet Jesus lay. He borrowed it because he wasn't going to be there for a little while. And it was just symbolic. There he gave his life, and then when he wanted it back, he got it back. The Bible says that self-same spirit, because Jesus having keys to the grave, that self-same spirit one day will rise you and me up. Pooh. Wouldn't you have liked to have been a fly on the wall in that tomb? If you had been a fly and you'd have witnessed that, you'd have automatically become an angel. There was so much love poured out in that spot that Jesus stood up. Could you imagine him unwrapping his head and said, "Whew, thanks, Dad. It's good to be back from down there. What's next?" He says, "Go out and prove that you're alive." He said, "I'll give you 40 days and you can come home." He said, "But until then, reassure your followers that because you were able to do this in the power of heaven, that they too can receive the same power if they only believe in you and what you've done." There's the opening. If you want to know the sales operation, y'all get stuff on your phone every now and then, everything's on sale. Alert. Yeah. If you ain't careful, it's actually more than what it was at another store. But the sales pitch came out then. Jesus said, from this point on, he says, my disciples are going to go tell him. And he even told his disciples this. He says, I'm gone, guys. I'm telling you, after this 40 days, I'm gone. And he lifted up from there, and Peter and them watched him, and the angels turned around and says, what are y'all doing? This same Jesus, which you've seen raised from the dead, is going to come back like mine, or just like he told you. So go do the Great Commission. Tell all the world that Jesus Christ is Lord. Convince them to be born again. Convince them that he's worth it all. Convince him that he has have power over death, hell, and the grave. That through him you might have joy. You might have peace. And the great consolation is eternity with him in a place called heaven. Who John the Revelator wrote out a picture of it. And man, I'll tell you, if it's just that, it's enough. But the Bible says, eyes have not seen, nor ears heard what God has got laid up for his folks. Are you part of the family? Do you know him today? I'll tell you, I like this. I'm confident in the consolation. I'm confident in that spirit that I feel. How do I know he's real? Because he lives within my heart. And I don't have to wait on him like I do a doctor to come in. I was having a little issue with my tractor, and Brother Larry was giving me a fit. Even told one of his buddies about it. Said, yeah, his tractor's acting up a little bit. And I had to, you know, it needs a good air filter, and it needs clean fuel filters. You know, if you tie it, you don't want to buy them until it just quits. But nevertheless. So I give it all that. And that man told Brother Larry, said, well, just tell Brother Jamie to lay hands on that thing. I said, let me tell you, I done laid prayers on this thing. Did y'all know that God is a mechanic? Did you know he was a builder? Did you know he's a way maker? Did you know he was a chain breaker? Did you know he was the greatest forgiver? Did you know he's a healer? Did you know he is life everlasting? He's everything that you want, wrapped up in one. Do you know him today? You can't turn him away. His name is Jesus. Accept him today. Do what you can for him to stand. Father, in your precious name, the name that's above every name, according to the word of God, that the name of Jesus, Father, anything can be done. By calling on the name of Jesus, the Bible says you can be saved. God, following him, you have all things in this life to offer because you have riches based on what you have in heaven. God, I pray this morning that no one will leave here not saved. God, I pray that they would come. There's people here that know to do better. But your word says that he that knoweth to do good but don't do it, to him is sin. It's still sin. But God, I pray they answer the call. I pray they answer the walk. Whether it's down here by me or down somewhere in their heart, Lord, they ask you to come in, to start being the leader of their life and the Lord and the shepherd. One that'll be faithful to the end. One that'll be closer than a brother. One that'll never forgive him, forget him, and always forgive him. God, I pray we'll accept him today. He is our all in all. God, have your will and way through the Spirit of God that you left with mankind. Lord, that it would deal. God, I don't have convincing words, but God, the Spirit is convincing because you can change the way a man feels. You can take hate and put love in. You can get the stubbornness and you can put forgiveness in and humility, and pride has to leave. God, I pray that it works on them today. God, I pray your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. In your precious name we pray. Amen and amen. Let's sing together.
Into my heart, into my heart, come into my heart, Lord Jesus.
thank y'all for being here this morning. I pray the words will stick in your heart. Not only that, I pray that that feeling sticks with you. I want what I got feeling right now to last me till I come back. I might run all the way back home. But I pray if it's not such a good feeling with you, that it'll stay there. He's doing it because he loves you. He wants you. You ever thought like no one wanted you? That you were worthless, and he wants you. It's better than getting a call from the President of the United States, man. You're talking to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He's wanting you to act on him because he loves you. Oh, I can't love you that way, but if you'll come, I'll try my best. But I'll have to turn it over to him because I can't do it. But he does. He wants you. Listen, come back tonight. We got a special presentation that's going to happen tonight. We're going to have a young girl who decided to fall in love with Jesus, accept him. And her grandpa is going to baptize her tonight. Not only that, if he ain't forgot, he's supposed to preach a little bit for us too. Praise the Lord. What an opportunity. If you want to know what it's like for a pastor to get rewarded, a soul to be baptized, family or non-family, because when that moment, we're all become family. But he asked me, and the family asked me about it, and I said, you know what? What a great time. What a great moment to look back and say, honey, where'd you get saved? And you tell him, you know who the pastor was at Baptist? Yeah, my grandpa did. Where are you at, grandpa? Are you ready for that? I pray that you are. Okay. Amen. Y'all have a great afternoon. I tell you, I love you. I love every one of you. I don't see who we are. Somebody must have done left. Anyway, Father, we thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name, for what you have done and what you're going to do. God, and I sincerely pray, Lord, that these doors is an escape. It's also a place, Lord, that we can run out and spread the gospel, or we can run from your presence. God, I pray we think on those things. God, that you would change hearts. God, we love you. We thank you for what you've done today. We pray, Lord, we come back, God, it'd just be that much and more. God, have your will and way. Give us all safe traveling mercies. And God bless America. In your precious name. Amen.